So 2 Chronicles chapter 24, 2 Chronicles 24 is where we're looking this morning. And of course, the parallel passage to 2 Chronicles 24 is 2 Kings 11. Now, I wanted to end with this, but I will mention this at the outset that, you know, the arrangement of, it's not the message, but it is somewhat important. When you look at 2 Chronicles, as we've been doing, it's parallel to 2 Kings. I mean, you look at this, and some of the stories are there, some are missing. But in the Hebrew arrangement of the Old Testament, so you got the law and the prophets, and then you have somewhat historical, you have other books that would not be included in the law and the prophets. For instance, when you look at your Bible, let's pull it out here. You've got Ruth, you've got Samuel, you got Kings, you got different things mentioned here, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, you got all these things. In the Hebrew arrangement, before the arrangement of how the King James Version laid it out or different translators, 2 Chronicles in the Hebrew arrangement was the last book of the Hebrew arrangement of how they read the scriptures. And it sounds kind of strange. And in looking at both parallel passages and the story today with Zechariah, it just kind of set me down this biblical rabbit hole of, you know, again, we know somewhat why they do this, but Jesus referred to Zechariah. Some believe it's this Zechariah in the New Testament. But 2 Chronicles is a summation of the history of Israel, and it's a reminder to people. And it, in the Hebrew reading of it, it's the last book of the Old Testament. So when people like Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the intertestamental period, so between Malachi, the last book that's listed in our Bible, to Matthew, there's 400 years of a gap where there's nothing written. You can go into other writings. There's the Maccabean Revolution, the Book of the Maccabees. There's all types of things. When Rome came in and took over all the revolutions, it must be like our history in our country. If all the history we knew was starting at 2020 and moving forward, it'd be kind of sad because it's lockdown, it's COVID, it's all these other things. But if you lost all that time and generations to come look back and like, what happened between this point and this point? Well, 2 Chronicles, the Hebrews, the Jews will look at it as a reminder because the temple, if you remember, at the end of this, the temple's destroyed and there's problems. And so as you look at the Babylonians coming in, Judah and Israel being totally obliterated, they're already split at the start of 2 Kings. We saw that. Or at the beginning of 1 Kings, it split up. What they're doing at the end of this is looking forward to when the Messiah, when will the one come? When will the rebuilding of the temple? And of course, we see that happen when the Babylonian exiles, they come out and they come back. We see that with Nehemiah. So I mention that because at the close of today, we're going to kind of circle back around to it. And it's very important that the Bible is put together in such a way that it's instructive. It tells us what we need to know. And this story is just like a story we would deal with. So for instance, when you're living in the shadow of someone who has a lot of influence, they're very important in your life. They are a father or a mother figure, or they are an actual parent. When someone in your life that is super influential dies, and you're either a child, you're a young adult, or you're a grown adult, and that parent, that person dies in your life, or they're no longer there, what do you do? What happens? Not, you know, how do you grieve and what are the arrangements, but what choices will you make when the shadow of that important person is no longer cast upon your life? So we look at kids today think of John F. Kennedy, the pictures of his children and his mother as they're walking, and you're seeing little John saluting as the casket's going by, and America had watched those kids as they grew up, and you think of children growing up without their father. That happens in America a lot, but some of them in the public eye. And then you see the choices that these kids make, and they're living in the shadow of their father. And this story is exactly that. But what we see in the story, there are two sons, One is going to go this way. He starts out good, and he literally drops off the cliff into chaos and madness. The other son follows in his father's footsteps, and when the dad dies, when the dad is gone, this guy drops off the cliff. This guy stands up and says, this is wrong. And it's a classic version of, even though Adam was alive, of Cain and Abel, of, I won't say Jacob and Esau, but you see in the Bible where brothers struggled against each other, where they would fight each other. They had problems. And this story really is symbolized in, as I've mentioned here under the title, what will you do when your dad is gone? Maybe you had a close relationship with your dad, maybe not. But here are the two names. Josiah sadly declines. Zechariah boldly defies. So Zechariah is going to stand up and say, this is wrong. What you're doing is wrong. You shouldn't be doing this. He's not a tattletale and know-it-all. He's not a brat. He's a grown man under the influence of the Lord that is telling his brother, who happens to be the king, prime minister, the president, you can't do that. And what does the brother, what does Joash do? Well, you're going to find out in this chapter. It's pretty sad, so much so that most people believe Jesus is referring to Zechariah. He talks about him in the New Testament. There are three Zecharias in the Old Testament. There's a king, there's a prophet, there's the book of Zechariah, and then there's this guy, Zechariah. So some believe this Zechariah is one of them. We're not going to make the case for that, but however, let's look at 2 Chronicles 24, look at verse 17. So now after the death of Jehoiada, this is the guy who lived over 100 years. He saved Joash, this one-year-old child, with his wife. They hid him away from Jezebel's daughter so that he wouldn't be killed. So when this guy died, came the princes of Judah, made obeisance to the king. They came, these sniveling politicians came to the new king and said, or to the king that was, you know, what can we do? How can we help you? Then the king hearkened, listened to them, and they left the house of the Lord of God, their fathers. They served groves and idols, and wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this their trespass. We mentioned last week, if Cuba, Ukraine, Russia, China all came against America, who, Canada, Mexico, and the president said, we'll empty out Fort Knox. We'll give you the actual artifacts from Benjamin Franklin, George Washington. You can have the actual Declaration of Independence. We'll give you the Bell Tower. We'll give you the Washington Monument. We will lift up the Statue of Liberty. You can have it right in Tiananmen Square. Americans will be like, are you nuts? What are you doing? Well, that's what Joash is going to do. He is going to go against what God has said. He is allowing idol worship in the land. And so what happens here, verse 19, God sent prophets to them to bring them again to the Lord. They testified against them, but they would not give ear. They wouldn't listen. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada the priest. Okay, now we have another character. Who is this? He's the actual blood son. Joash is the nephew. But we know how that works. Abraham and Lot. Abraham didn't have a son for many years. He was 75 or 70, somewhere around there when he left. Lot came with him. His daddy had died. So Lot was kind of like a son to Abraham. So what we have here is Jehoiada is the dad, Zechariah is the son, his cousin is Joash. So, but I'm going to see my cousin in a few weeks, and we grew up like brothers. We're closer than cousins. We're like brothers. So here are these two boys. So one son, Joash, the king, saved at 1 year old, became the king at 7 years old. He's now 48. 47, he's somewhere around there, and he is about to make some decisions. So what happens? The brother, the cousin, he's an actual priest following in his father's footsteps. The Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada the priest, which stood above the people and said unto them, so it's not in a room, he's getting up in the pulpit before the people. Thus saith God, why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. That's not a nice message to say in this environment where people are doing what they want. Why would you be mean like that? Why would you speak these words? Why would you do this? That's what some people are going to say. Verse 21, and they conspired against him. and stoned him with stones. So what it is here, the people he was talking to, the people in the land, the common people, they conspired against him and stoned him with stones. What's the next part? At the commandment of the king. So his brother, his cousin, the man he grew up with, ordered his killing. Where? In the court of the house of the Lord, the very place that Joash, at 7 years old, some 40 years earlier, was crowned the king. His grandmother came in and said, "This is treason." You remember that? We looked a month ago, and Jehoiada said, "Take her out. No bloodshed in here. Take her out by the gate and kill her." I mean, Jezebel's daughter. The king commanded that his brother, his cousin, this man of God, be killed in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness which Jehoiada his father had done to him, but slew his son. He's an ingrate, right? Short memory. You know how it is. We do things for someone, and it's not like you want them, I scratch your back, you scratch mine. But when you're kind to someone, the world says it's karma. But the Bible says you reap what you sow. The world says karma, it goes around, comes around. But right here, Jehoiada and his wife risked their lives to save this boy when Athaliah, Jezebel's daughter, was slaughtering children so that she could have the throne. They protected this child for 6 years and hid him. And they helped him. And when Jehoiada died and Joash went off the cliff, Zechariah said, "This is wrong. This isn't right." You talk about having a family fight at the funeral. People fight about all kinds of things, whether it's inheritance, it's the family, it's the classic car in the garage, it's money, it could be a number of things, the jewelry, whatever. And it's not even that. They're not fighting over those. They're fighting over right and wrong. So he forgot. He slew his son. And when he died, when Zechariah died, he said, so as he's being stoned, much like Stephen, Acts chapter 7, "The Lord look upon it and require it," or that word means to repay it. He says, "Lord, you see this, you're watching this, you're seeing what's happening, Lord, repay." And it came to pass, verse 23, at the end of the year, that the host of Syria came up against him. We'll stop there. It's coming around. Hazael, who we've already met, there's a guy out there, Pastor Chris. I think he might be with ServPro if you want to go check with him. I'm not sure. Thank you. So it came to pass at the end of the year, the host of Syria came up against him. So Hazael is the king of Syria. We've already met him before. He's going to come up and make war, and Joash is going to go further in his action. So let's look at this, the introduction here. So King Joash's reign was successful, marked by his commitment to seeking godly counsel and following wise leadership. So Joash, he was a successful king. In the early days of his leadership, the kingdom enjoyed peace and prosperity. I mean, it's somewhat like that with the first term of a president, typically, right? You have the first term of a president, and you know, sometimes it goes well, sometimes it doesn't. Maybe if Congress or things change hands, it could go down. This guy had it in the early days. There was peace after Jezebel, after Athaliah. It was great. Additionally, Joash oversaw the temple's restoration, which had fallen into disrepair. But despite his many achievements, Joash fell short of a complete commitment to God and godliness. He lost his way when his godly uncle was no longer alive, and he began listening to ungodly advisors. Joash did not remove false worship and the high places, and when confronted by his godly family about his wrongdoings, he resorted to violence and murder. So what Cain confronted Abel? "Hey, will you talk to me out in the field? You know, mom and dad are, let's walk a little further. Let's get out of sight. We'll go over the hill. Let's talk, brother. What do you want to talk about?" And he kills him. So what we see here, instead of it being that way, this man does what's right. He confronts a family member who's doing wrong. We can just put it in that context. You and I may never get to confront President Obama, President Trump, President Biden, Governor DeSantis, the mayor of Timbuktu. We may never get to confront anybody. We don't have that platform. Because number one, they're not family. Number two, we're here, they're there. This is family. So he says, this is wrong. When you speak to family, whether it's a son, a daughter, a sibling, a spouse, someone, and you say, I don't think this is right, what do they usually do with that opinion that you share with them? Is it hard to share the opinion with someone in your family when they are making such open, sinful choices? Don't do this. He's doing it, and it's bringing down the entire nation, which includes families, children. They're going and offering sacrifices to these idols. They're not worshiping the true God, and it's bringing back everything that they had just worked to destroy. The same guy that started good is now bringing those things in. It's much like, as we've talked about here, he's reigning for 40 years. If President Obama was still president and he was elected in 2008, or President Trump was still president and he was elected in 2016, or President Bush was still president, he was elected in 2000, and we're in 24. We're halfway there through his reign. Can you imagine? Where over the years, some decisions that they make would be very good. Wow, this is great. Other decisions would be like, what is he doing? You're doing this to us. Our politicians have 4 or 6 years, and you know. So what happens? Zechariah says, this is wrong. This isn't right. And instead of repenting or saying, let's talk about it, he chose violence and, of course, ultimately murder. So instead of taking a stand against evil, we'll see next week, his pragmatic choices led him down a path of madness and chaos. Who in the world would give away the Declaration of Independence or the Constitution? Or the Statue of Liberty, for that matter? They seem like silly, but he gives away the very treasures of the temple to a foreign king so that he will leave him alone. Unfortunately, Joash's reign came to a tragic end. We'll see next week when his followers turned on him and they took his life. So in his weakest moment, this once successful king is going to lose his life by the very people who propped him up. His story has come full circle from success to decline, culminating in his downfall. On the other hand, who we're going to hit today to talk about, Zechariah, who was more like a brother to Joash, bravely spoke out against Joash's sin. He stood alone for the Lord when no one else cared, and he lost his life for doing what was right. Thus, two boys, same dad, different outcomes. It doesn't matter who your daddy is. It's what you do with your life that counts. And it doesn't matter if when your dad is gone, they can't make the choice for you. These two boys had a godly father. Jehoiada, there's no question. He's buried where the kings are buried. He's buried where the presidents are buried. He was a godly man, and he imparted that wisdom to both of his sons. But it can't be any more clear. Adam and Eve had two boys, and the boy killed the other one. They probably felt like failures as parents. And sometimes as parents, Jehoiada didn't live to see this, but you think about that. David thought about this. There's Absalom, his son. There's Solomon, his son. All of us, if you have children or if you were in a family that had multiple children or you know people that have a bunch of children, every child is different. Some are a carbon copy of their mom or dad. Some are not. We're not here to get into the psyche of all that. But ultimately, we see in the Bible, you can't live in the shadow of an influential figure forever. You have to make your own choice. And so this man at 40 plus years of age, when Jehoiada died, he said, well, now that he's gone, I have no underpinning. I have no foundation. I'm going to follow the crowd. Do 40-year-old men and women follow the crowd? You better believe it. Of course they do. Do 50-year-old men and women? Yes. So, two boys, same dad, different outcomes. Look at the points we have before. We saw the reforms of Jehoiada led to a revival all the way back in 11. We saw the rise and reign of Joash, 7 years old. Great. We saw the death of Jehoiada. And last week, we started on the decline of Joash. This is where it goes off the rails. We mentioned 2 points. A weak leaders are recognized by who leaves them, who they let in, and who they listen to. Jehoiada dies, he's gone. And then Joash says, I'll listen to these friends. You know, you hear the term, they would roll over in their grave if they knew. Sometimes you hear that about past presidents or politicians. Our presidents must be spit in their grave knowing what's going on in Washington. Sometimes we use that in the context of someone's parents. They'd turn over in their grave if they knew what they were doing. Meaning they'd be disappointed. They're just like, I can't stand to see this. I'm going to turn over. Well, when Jehoiada dies, this weak leader, Joash, who was a good leader when the influence of his uncle was there, uncle's gone, he starts making poor decisions. B, weak leaders refuse to listen to wisdom or counsel and react aggressively to those who try to help. Sometimes you see that with an animal, and I can hear Sarah McLaughlin singing in the background, and the cameras coming into the animals, the cats and the dogs and the cages, and they're shaking their tails between their legs, and the sad eyes and the sad music, and you just want to adopt every single cat and dog and turtle, whatever. Well, when an animal who has been abused, mistreated, or left to die, even when someone who's trying to help comes in and they're trying to help it, that dog, that cat, they are very apprehensive. They might try to bite. They're maybe not totally aggressive, but they can't trust. Well, what we see here, Joash, who is a weak leader, he's really backing himself into a corner, his own choice, and he won't listen to wisdom, and he surrounds himself with people who are yes men, brown-nosing yes men, that are saying, let's do this, and he just goes along with them. And when someone comes into that circle, into that cage, into his life and says, this is wrong, he says, eliminate that guy. I don't like that person. You know, from the top down, we all know people maybe in our lives or in movies, they make movies about this kind of stuff, stories, great stories. But do you have someone in your life that when you try to speak truth to them, they about bite your head off? Has that ever happened to you? A son, a daughter, a friend, a neighbor, maybe as a spouse, sometimes we go through that. I don't want my bread buttered that way. Why don't you want your bread buttered that way? Now, I don't put bread on my butter, and we've never had that. But again, as spouses, can we be upset with each other? Of course. Cousins, brothers, sisters, family, friends, but not to the point of, okay, let's get a posse together. Let's go out and hang this guy. Let's stone him. Let's kill him. Let's wait till he's alone and kill him. That's what he does. So, number one, God sent Zechariah, King Joash's cousin and son of Jehoiada, to rebuke him for sin and compromise. Sometimes we speak in anger when someone does something wrong, and it's important that we don't do that, that we try, at least with our emotions, to handle it right, to speak with wisdom, to listen intently, and not to react aggressively. I'll give you that. And we see it on the floor of many other bodies of parliament or their judicial bodies in China and Asia and Europe. You've seen them on the floor of their house where politicians are punching each other. Can you imagine if, who's the guy from Mitch McConnell and Nancy Pelosi were going at it? Now, I would actually watch C-SPAN for that. I might not. I'd be like, wow, let's record this. This is interesting. Mitch McConnell and Nancy Pelosi. But can you imagine if that was happening in Washington now and they were fighting? Well, when they couldn't solve this, what we see is God sent Zechariah, the king's cousin, someone that it comes from good authority, God, to this priest who had authority and someone who Joash knew that would, if he wouldn't listen to him, he's not going to listen to anybody. Number two, it says in the verse, and I've bolded each part of the verse so you don't have to keep going back and forth. It says, number two, the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada. So this is pretty significant. It's only in the Old Testament, only mentioned three other times as relates to a prophet, and I've listed those for you. Two of the three examples of this expression are found in the book of Chronicles. So there are three times that this is mentioned, and two of them are here. So God is going to pronounce judgment through this prophet. But what is probably going to happen? Let's step back and then step forward. Let's go to the New Testament. There was a man preaching who wore camel hair. He ate locust and wild honey, and he looked like a woolly booger coming from the desert. And what did he come? He was preaching repent. He was baptizing. But what got him in trouble? They never tried to kill him when he's baptizing people in the Jordan. They didn't try to kill him when he was preaching repent. When did they try to kill him, and when did they actually kill him? When he pointed his finger up at Herod and said, "What you're doing is wrong. You have taken your brother's wife. You're doing wrong." I mean, listen, preach your salvation repentant stuff, preacher, but just stay off of our personal lives. Well, he didn't, and this is what Zechariah is about to do. And God is going to pronounce judgment on him and the nation. Number three, it says in the verse here, verse number 20, he stood above the people. So he held a leadership position as a priest. So his dad's gone. It makes sense. He's standing above. That's the idea of where they stand on the platform or where they stand above the people. It indicates, number two, that he was a prominent priest who led the reading or the prayer, or the sermon for the assembly. When they came together, the house of the Lord had been in disrepair. Now it's there. Number four, what does he say? "Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord that you cannot prosper?" In verse 5, "Because you have forsaken the Lord, he has also forsaken you." Now, I watched when King Charles was crowned. I got up and watched that. I watched when Queen Elizabeth, when she died, I watched the whole thing. We got up. Now, again, because I'm married into British royalty. I don't know if they're royalty or not. And my English accent, every time I try to do something, the kids are like, "Dad, please don't. It's an embarrassment." But because we watched that, I remember when Princess Diana died and my in-laws and the whole family, how everything still over across the pond, as they say, still impacts them. But I watched that, and in those services, you have everyone there. The king's going to be crowned. Someone has died. They're going to church, and you have the royal family lined up. You have the common people back there. You have the heads of everything, the guards. And the homily, which is another name for sermon, the homily is given, and everybody's there. So at the homily on the Sabbath, whenever this was, get it in your mind, maybe it played out this way, he's standing above the people. He's given his homily on the Sabbath day. People are there listening to the Word of God, the law of God, and the land's in disrepair, and he goes there with him sitting there. So if President Biden or President Trump or President Obama, their cabinet, Supreme Court, let's just imagine the State of the Union, and they invite a preacher to pray and to do whatever, a prophet, and he gets up and says, "Come to order, God's got a problem with you people. And you're going to take it. Because you have forsaken God, he is forsaken." Can you imagine? What would they do to him? Well, they would railroad him out of there. But that's what's happening here. They're all here. So imagine the embarrassment from Joash. "There goes my crazy brother. Oh my goodness. He's so incensed. He's angry." So look at number one under five. The writer intentionally included this part in the account to emphasize its significance to the return to exiles during the time Chronicles was written. And by the way, when you look at 2 Kings 12, where we've been, this particular part is not mentioned in that aspect. Again, why the Chronicles are kind of a summation, a reminder, kind of a conclusion of the Old Testament of this time period. What does James, the half-brother of Jesus, say? He understood the message. He says, here's the principle. You take a step to God, and he'll take a step to you. So the inverse would be true. You back up from him. Now, not salvation is secure. You're a believer. But can we get away from the Lord, from what he wants from us by the actions we take? Can we do that? Of course. Even if you're saved, sealed, delivered, you're still living in this flesh, in this world. So here is Joash. His uncle died. He invites other people in. He listens to them. Sure, go do that. He keeps stepping back. By the way, God doesn't move. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Draw nigh to God, he draws nigh to us. So James says, basically, you need to get back to God. Number six, so what happens? He preaches this homily, gives this homily. Number six, they conspired, it says in the verse here, verse number 21. They conspired against him at the command of the king and stoned him in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus, I summarize, Joash forgot the kindness of Jehoiada to him, but killed his son. Why would he do that? Why? There's all kinds of stories, movies, books written about people who take up the child to raise it as their own, and then this child that is raised up as their own becomes this great figure, and the person who knew their parents and did all this, I mean, they, I will repay the debt, whatever it might be, all kinds of stories. Great stories. Joash is like, forget that. You spoke against me, my kingdom, my decisions. I don't care who your daddy is. I don't care what your relationship to me is in the past or in the present. You're dead. And that's what he does. Number one, so what happens? Zechariah speaks. He was met with hostility from both leaders and common people who disagree with his message. Okay, that's fine. You can be hostile. Number two, they reacted with aggression and used lethal force to silence him by taking his life. So not only are we upset about this, the king said, kill him. Kill him in the very court. So in the foyer of the church. Make an example. Can you imagine that? So on the Sabbath day, whenever that was, or maybe it's in his priestly duties, the people were so incensed because the king gave them permission and they took his life in the foyer. The blood of that priest, that preacher, was in the foyer of the church. Number three, the people did not listen to the Lord's command, but they did listen to the evil command of Joash. He's the one, you see it in verse 21, at the commandment of the king, they conspired against him, stoned him with stones. So who's got the problem here? The people are going to follow the leaders. We might not like our leaders all the time, but as a whole, the Bible says we are to pray for them, we are to support them, we are to love them, we are to honor them, but we don't always go along with them. These people go along with what the king said. In fact, it harkens back. Let's go back two generations. Is it two? Do you remember what Ahab and Jezebel did? Jezebel went to Samaria. She went to Naboth's vineyard in Jezreel. And she paid the city officials, do you remember that? To lie about Naboth. I want you to lie and say that he blasphemed God and the king. She paid them off. And then they brought Naboth up before his neighbors who had been paid off. And they lied and they killed him. And Elijah, the prophet, says, the same place where his blood was spilled, your blood's going to be spilled. And don't even get me started on you, Jezebel, because it's coming for you too. That is what's happening here. And number four, it's despicable. Joash killed a prophet and the son of a man who saved his life and raised him to the throne. So let's bring this in for a landing here. Think about it. Zechariah had lost a father, his father, and no one around him cared about God or doing right. Despite this, he was bold and faithful and chose to do what was right. So on the one hand, you have Abel, you have Zechariah. On the other hand, Joash was easily influenced by his friends who happened to be evildoers, and would cave in when he was alone. He was just, he wilt like a flower, wax in the hot sun. So two ironies here. Joash was cruel to Jehoiada's son, despite Jehoiada's kindness towards him. I mean, it's just, why would someone do that? Why would you turn your back on the man and his family who saved you just because there was a disagreement? So Zechariah was murdered. Second irony, Zechariah was murdered where his dad had anointed his cousin as the king. They brought him out. I mean, you can just see, you talk about political intrigue. Look at Washington. You can see there's a picture of Bill Clinton in the 60s shaking the hand of John F. Kennedy. Some of y'all have seen that. He's at some rallies. I think he's on the White House lawn. He's there. Sometimes you see the intersection of life and politics or world power, and people in their mind have to go back here. Now remember, Chronicles is written as a reminder, a summation of all that has happened in Israel. And they have gone away from God. They have stepped back from God. They keep going back. And Zechariah's message was, repent. Because you have forsaken God, he has forsaken you now. Number seven, as he died, this is what he said. the Lord look upon it and require or repay it. He says, God is not happy with us. I've listed some verses for you. I'm just going to read them. They're very brief. 1 Samuel 24, David is saying this to Saul. Saul came after David and says, I'm going to kill you. And he was on the run for a decade. And David said this, when he could have killed Saul, the Lord judge between me and thee. The Lord avenge me of thee, but my hand shall not be on thee. He says, I'm not going to touch you. I'm going to let the Lord deal with you. Because if I touch you, it might hurt. But if God deals with you, he'll get you. Proverbs 20, 22. Say not thou, I will recompense or repay evil, but wait on the Lord, and he shall save thee. You say, well, that didn't do any good for Zechariah. Well, it didn't. He died, but he did what was right, and he has his reward. Stephen, in Acts chapter 6 and 7, preached, and they took his life. They were so angry, and as they were stoning him, he said, the Bible says, his face, he looked up, and Jesus stood up for Stephen and said, come on in. I mean, and he says, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. They were so angry, but the Bible teaches that. Romans 12, verses 19 through 21. Let me read a couple of these verses here. You know the verse 19. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is yours. Right? God is saying, you settle them up. You deal with it. You go full Arnold Schwarzenegger, you go full whatever action figure it is. You just load up and you go. No, he says, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. So if your enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. For in so doing, you'll heap coals of fire on his head. It messes with people when you're nice to them when they hate you. That's obviously Joash doesn't really care. He's seeing red. I don't really care if you're my brother, if you're my cousin, I don't care. But God's word says you don't be overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Finally, Jesus said this, Matthew chapter 5, which I don't have listed. You know this, blessed are ye when men shall revile you, persecute you, say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake, not because you're an idiot, not because I'm digging my own hole and I keep going down because of my bad choices. But if I'm serving the Lord, and I'm working the trenches for Jesus, and I'm trying just to do what's right and keep people out of hell and try to save them from hell, and I'm being persecuted for his sake, he says, verse 12, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. So the Bible simply says that they did this to them. What do you think they're going to do to you? What are they going to do to us? The 4 points, and we're done. We have 2 minutes. Some say this Zechariah was the last martyr mentioned in the Hebrew arrangement of the Old Testament. Now, if the arrangement of the Hebrew Old Testament, which we don't have in our Bible, but 2 Chronicles as a summation, fine. Some, number two, think this is who Jesus talked about in Matthew 23 and Luke 11. And it says in those two verses, and I'll summarize here, Jesus said to them, the blood that upon you may come, all the righteous blood shed upon earth, from the blood of the righteous Abel unto the blood of Zacharias, whom you slew between the temple and the altar. Jesus is speaking. You are doing this. He's speaking to the religious leaders. Number three, Zechariah's last words to God were a request for justice instead of personal revenge. I don't know about you, but when you look around at our climate today and you see how people are just, you know, taking advantage of other people, of the system. They're taking advantage of children. They're taking advantage of, I mean, just whatever it is. We want justice, but it's not for us to go rogue like Batman, right? Hi, Batman. And I'm going to go and deal with this. And, you know, it sounds nice. It looks great. But we can't do that. It's not a biblical attribute to go and knock someone's lights out. In Jesus' name, receive this. No. We like those movies. We enjoy those shows. We read those books, but that's not life. Number four, this prayer that he prayed is perfect for the persecuted. It entrusts all vengeance to the wisdom and to the hands of God. So have we been mistreated? Have we been falsely accused? Have we been let down? Have we been trampled over? Have we been hurt? Yeah, all of us have been. But the question is, are we going to react when someone speaks to our sin in a way like Joash? I'm going to rally the troops and I'm going to destroy you if it's the last thing I do, and it will be the last thing you do. Or are we going to be like Zechariah and stand up and say, this isn't right. This is what the Bible says, and you need to correct it. It's hard to do this. It's fun to do that. This is hard to do because no one wants to be the bad guy. And nobody wants to die. I don't want to die. I want to be stoned to death. You want to be stoned to death? No. But let's close today by thinking about and praying for people in our own families, who in our friends, our neighbors, that we either have spoken to and they've just kind of cut you off. I'm not listening to you. Or people that we need to speak to that we haven't, that we can see they're heading towards the cliff for whatever reason. And you got to think, Zechariah saw his brother doing this, and he's the priest. He knows the history. He's like, my goodness, we were boys together. We grew up together. What's going on? I mean, teenagers seeing their dad do all these things, and then when he's gone, he immediately loses his mind and leads the nation down a dark path. If someone doesn't speak up to people that you love, if we don't do that, then do we truly love people if we don't tell them the truth? But we have to do it in a way that when they come at us, as they say, don't come at me, bro. When they come at us, we have to just say, Lord, they did this to you. They did this to the prophets. So, Lord, I share in that. But not, we're not trying to play the part of a victim. We're just trying to speak the truth so that they might be saved. So I pray that you'll have the courage, the boldness, the wisdom, the empathy, the compassion to speak to the ones you love about the needs they have. And should I go down that path, should you go down that path, I pray that you would be some of the ones that would come at me, and that I would be the one that would come at you. When someone leaves or someone does something like this, you can speak to them, and the reaction might be varied, but Joash's reaction was pretty, you know, extreme. But we still need to speak to people, at least in the way of the New Testament, where you give them the truth, they have to make the choice. I can't choose for them. I can't choose for my kids, but I can still be there when it's time to come back. I'm here to help you. Train up a child in the way he is go, and when he is old, see, that's a principle, not a promise. Because Jehoiada trained those boys up and one went off the rails. The principle is you have to grow up sometime. And let's pray for our kids as well and our grandkids. Okay, let's pray.